Yeah. Bible underneath my right hand, I made it out of tight jams. Guns all on my nightstand, my life should be on Viceland. My fingertips to hold the marijuana aroma. High school, I went to school high, still got my diploma. He got riddled and left alone for some Skittles in Arizona. The same time a man dies by his own for a pair of Jordan. It's crazy how we living, we all misguided children. Niggas out here getting got, trying to figure out how to get it. We the ones that's not afraid to let the hammers off. The same ones that feed the homeless with the cameras off. The life I'm living kinda hard to get a handle on. But I'm blessing, God knows I can't be mad at all.
Dan Perri is one of my great friends. He's my barber. He's been cutting my hair for so many years now. And just a really awesome stylist. This guy has incredible ideas and he's so down to earth. And you could talk to him about absolutely anything. And just an incredible entrepreneur spirit.
Homie.
My dude.
Good to see you, man. Thanks for sliding through.
Yo, what's up? It's Uncreative Radio. I'm with my man, Dan Perri in the house. DP.
What up?
My barber. My personal barber.
Personal groomer.
Men's groomer.
That's right.
I don't even know. What do we even call you, man?
I think in LA, I'm a groomer.
You're a groomer.
Because it goes farther.
Yeah, because you're, obviously, you're cutting hair, but you're also on set.
Yeah.
Like, you're doing.
I'm doing makeup.
You're doing makeup. You're doing everything.
Nine yards.
You're doing everything.
Yeah, I think the whole definition of grooming.
Yeah, and
barber kind of limits you. Just cut hair.
Absolutely. And for everyone that doesn't know, I can't name you. I know some people I can't say, but you're cutting some names.
Yeah,
now.
I'm making my way.
You're doing some names.
Yeah.
You're doing some names.
It's happening. It's happening when you know you can't really mention it on the radio.
Yeah.
Or a live.
But yeah, you're doing some. You're making some real big moves.
Yeah,
you're cutting some real folks.
It's been awesome. It's been quite the journey to get there, but it's happening. You know, everything's paying off. So it's been.
Now you're, you know, and I met you through your brother,
right?
But back in Florida,
yeah.
And then you had a book of business back there already.
Like yeah, people. That's where it all started. So I'm originally from South Florida, and I had a shop. I was working in a shop there, and my first barbershop was where I worked at. So I built the whole book out there before I took on
and
LA.
I think that's the biggest challenge, right? So you had this whole book of business and you basically said like, sayonara.
Pretty much. I did that almost three times and it's hard, you know, it's like saying goodbye to, you know, close people who you have such a connection with. And, I first moved to New Jersey and that's when I first did it. I cut the clients and set them out and just went to Jersey. Did that for 2 years, built clientele out there. Which was almost even harder to kind of leave because those guys out there were like next level. Picky.
Yeah.
You know, they were so picky. They needed haircuts every week. It was head to toe almost of grooming. And, you know, leaving them was like, you're joking, right?
Right.
Where are you going?
Right.
Like, why would you even leave?
People start to fight. Like when you find your guy.
Yeah. I get it. Yeah. Absolutely.
Like I fly to LA for you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Exactly. You wait.
Yeah. Like, what's the point?
It's great.
But it's tough too. So then you did the Jersey thing. And then what happened after Jersey?
So after Jersey, I came home as a pit stop.
Yeah.
Towards Cali. So coming home was just kind of like
getting
back in together. Yeah. Saving a little bit of money and kind of just getting my feet back on the ground and recharging.
Why did you want to do LA? Like, what made you thought, like, all right, I'm going to do this in LA?
Well, LA was actually the original plan with my brother. Mm. And, you know, I met a girl. And, you know, how that goes, the rest of the story. So she was also in the industry, and I felt that it was a calling for me to look into this. So I put the LA trip on pause and did, like, a little detour.
Yeah.
And pretty much said to Joe, I'll meet him there type of thing.
Yeah.
Went to Jersey, did what I had to do, you know, and just didn't work out. But it brought me back to where I really wanted to go.
Yeah. Do you feel like most people, like, you have a plan. Sometimes it doesn't work out. But you got yourself back on track. Do you feel like some people have a hard time doing that?
Or they get kind of stuck in that? I feel like they're too caught up in their head with getting back on track.
Yeah.
You know, things happen for a reason. You become a product of your environment. You tend to think that this is how it's supposed to be and nothing will change or this can't really happen, you know.
Right.
And then it actually happens and you're in that position.
Right.
And you just naturally go, like it goes through your body, you naturally figure it out and adapt.
But so you made your reality though.
Like, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like you made this shit.
Yeah, it was I did.
Because when you came to LA, because I remember you're like, yo, man, because you didn't come to LA and it was just like, oh, smooth breezes.
I'm No, it was actually more challenging because moving to Jersey, I still was considered on the East Coast. So yeah. Getting more specific, you know, you have to have a license for California in the West Coast. It requires more hours, more school, and it just, it was just more of a challenge to drop a whole clientele on the East Coast and go back to school for two more months and kind of like really restart. So it was just all worth it though. I think my favorite quote of all time, which has always stuck with me, is hold the vision, trust the process. So at that point it was just like, if I looked at the process, I wouldn't take it back. I would be like, there's no way anybody would, you know, but the vision is more powerful.
What do you think it is with people that like you build? Cause most people, they get stuck, right? You build their business in South Florida or you built it in Jersey and like you know, barbers like that are people that just like, that's what they do.
Yeah.
They did it and that's it. They're not moving. What was it about the risk? Like what is the difference between people like, you know, that are business owners that take that risk? And cause that's some crazy shit.
I think once I found out how many opportunities this career had with hair and how many routes you can go.
Yeah.
And not just being behind the chair all day, every day.
Right.
Once I found out that I can actually do this on my own, I don't need a boss, I can kind of do freelance, I can just put myself in any position because everyone needs a haircut. Once I kind of figured that out, it was like an easier way to take a risk.
Right.
You know, I knew if I go here, someone's going to need a cut. And we build clientele and we start over. Instead of feeling like this is it. And that's my plan B. You know, going back to a shop and working full time is my plan B, which is still a win-win. I give it up to the people who are still doing that. You know, to each their own. They, you know, some people do wish they can step out of their bubble and leave, but they can't. But it's not necessarily bad that you're behind the chair.
Right, absolutely.
I just felt like, you know, being with my brother as well and as close as I am to him being a freelance photographer, I think I got motivated and inspired to take the leap of faith that he did as well, just with a different career. So
and then you stepped outside of haircuts. Like not like black people's hair too, you know, like you're like the homie, like in the hood, you know what I mean? But you stepped beyond that and into makeup on set.
Right. It's crazy how the story kind of went. If I look back at it all, like with my first shop, I would say I learned a lot from my boss. That was where I learned beginning stages of really getting into barbering, but I catered more towards, you know, maybe some senior citizens, older crowd, you know, your regular Boca Raton crew, you know? And then from that—
Shout outs to Boca
for sure. That's a fact. And Anthony's Barbershop.
Hey.
I think it closed down, but many memories. From there and then to Jersey. Jersey was more picky clients and learning how to really understand how people want things and how precise they want them. And then coming back home to Florida to my third shop before LA was a little bit more Latin and urban and, you know, just not knowing that all of these were just going to combine together. And by the time I go to Cali, I'm kind of like loaded and equipped.
Yeah.
So I think that I recognized that and I was like, well, I don't just have one thing to offer if I go there.
You know?
I can just kind of say I can do it all and give it a try and fall back on going to a shop, which isn't bad, you know?
And then you transition to on set photo shoots.
Yeah. So
when
I moved to LA, I mean, obviously networking was the main thing out there and it became an ongoing thing. And I realized where I really wanted to go, I would get there quicker if I had more knowledge, which was learning men's makeup. And, you know, I wanted to be on set. I wanted to work on shoots, but sometimes they don't just need the haircut, you know, they prefer it style, maybe a little makeup. And I didn't want to just get hired for hair because I felt like I'm not just looking at the hair.
Right.
I see image. I'm an image consultant. So I don't want to step on toes and call myself like a great makeup artist, but I feel like I just know what looks right. And I realized I didn't have that experience. So I picked that up and had some people along the way teach me and it just came natural. So.
Yeah. Well, tell me, we'll try to tell this story. You told me when you were cutting my hair the other day, and I'll leave the celebrity out of it, but let's just say he was a musician. But you were talking about how you really know that someone appreciated the cut when they call you back the second time.
Yeah.
But how do you sit in front of a celebrity? I'm talking, this is somebody that everybody in the world
knows. You just called me today, by the way.
Oh, hey, hey. How
ironically.
How do you sit in front of somebody like that and, if they trust you. So they're just like, yo, DP, hook it up. And then how do you do that and get over that celebrity status?
It takes a lot of mental practice. I think coming from humble beginnings and just being humble myself, I know where I came from in a sense. So like being in front of a celebrity and looking back on my journey, it's such like a process. So it's very easy to, acknowledge who's in front of me and kind of let that take over.
Right.
And my reason for being there is more important. And I feel like I have to really lock in my head, in my mind. And I try to not use the name or think of the person or tell anyone at the moment and just think of it as like another booking.
Right.
And it took a while because it was tough, you know?
I mean and if you fuck it up, that's
right. Right. You know, it's much more than who it is.
Right.
It's they don't even, you know, hit you up. It's more of their management. So it seems more like, oh, you know, I gotta go through management.
Right, right.
And so on and so forth. And then it's for this show or for this photo shoot, so on and so forth.
It's a big deal.
No pressure.
Music video, whatever.
Right. Yeah. And then, you know, it's a lot of like you gotta really get in here. And I think you get in here the right way.
Right.
And it's all on you. It's all in your mind. Everything is all in your mind. And I just kinda like trained my mind to lock in and enter the door and kind of just show up like I'm here to cut someone's hair kind of thing.
Yeah.
Cool, this is him. Nice. And then, you know, as time goes by, it sinks in when I leave and more so. So it's tough, but it's...
What would you say to other business owners or people that are in the shop trying to get out or anyone in the industry that are saying, hey, I'm trying to move to LA. Like everyone's trying to move to LA, right? You know what I mean? But you actually, they don't, I feel like when we started our company, you know, people see it on Instagram.
Yeah.
They see the shit you're doing, you know, and they're just like, I want to do that. But they don't understand the paces that you got to put yourself through to...
Yeah, it's a lot. I mean, obviously Instagram now shows what it looks like. You know, we're not posting the background stuff. We're not posting
New Jersey,
hey, this is me still cutting hair at 11 p.m. You
right,
know?
Exactly.
Just to get this guy who's so big the next day.
Right.
But it is a lot more of that. And I teach my classes. I teach men's grooming classes. And when I teach them, I kind of let them know that, like, a lot of people want things, but they don't really do anything to get there.
Do you really want it?
Do you really want it? So it's like, once you realize, like, I have clients. I mean, I have students I teach, and they say, or other hairstylists, they say, I want to raise my price. I want to do this. I want to do that. But where I'm at, I can't really do that. And it's just like, I think more people need to realize sometimes you have to take yourself out of your position where you are and relocate yourself to where those answers will be met.
Right.
You know what I mean?
You've really figured
it
out.
So it's like they're here if you move yourself here. So when you ask for it, it's like you can kind of step out and it's like in your face.
Right.
And you can pull it in together. So that's kind of like my advice on that end.
Do you feel like, you know, because I've seen you grow obviously in your career, and then every time I come back and get a cut, it's either in a different building, bigger space, newer space.
Yeah.
And then a little bit recently, your career got elevated when you got sponsored.
Yeah.
And so now people are wanting you to use their products.
Right.
Know? And then how did that happen and how did you...
Honestly, it's like the vision, you know, coming out of hair school, every hair school student has a vision. You know, I once saw myself teaching and I once saw myself doing, you know, celebrities and working on set. And I think what happened was, I think I just kept that in my head and I just kept working.
Yeah.
And, you know, I feel like hard work will never not pay off.
Right.
I don't think hard work will pay off with a certain time. I think once you have hard work and you put that hard work out there, it's gonna pay off.
Yeah.
There's people who get it the next day. There's people who get it next year. There's people that get it really late, you know? But like, I just felt like that mentality got me to where I was, and it was just a lot of
I don't even know how to say this. What are like the, your barber is kind of more than a barber. It becomes your homie.
Yeah.
He's around for you, maybe different players
in
different leagues. It becomes a part of the community. There's trust.
Yeah.
Your barber hears shit that he shouldn't hear.
Yes.
And you know, how do you build that trust with people on the celebrity side? And then also too, just on the regular everyday side.
I think ever since I moved into my own salon, I have my own salon suite in Hollywood. Being just me in there and having a one-on-one experience with a client and not having any interruptions or anybody else walking by, it kind of allowed me to lock in more to what they had to say.
Yeah.
It became more personal once they saw no one else is around.
Yeah.
So I learned over the years to kind of just adapt and be there for them. And, you know, all hairstylists are kind of like therapists in a sense.
Right,
you know,
absolutely.
We hear everything.
Absolutely.
Some people can't wait to say
right.
something to their hairstylist before the cut, you know? It's
right.
just like, I got to vent to you. So, I mean, over the years of cutting hair, we naturally became, you know, like a therapist and whatnot. So when I'm with clients or bigger clients or artists and celebrities, it's, you have to kind of look at, you know, they have chosen you to be in their
yeah,
inner circle.
Absolutely.
And how much they deal with and fans
absolutely.
And all of this, that it's just like you're in their space, your private
right.
space. So it's you, I feel like I naturally adapt. I'm like a chameleon.
Yeah.
Like I'll be your personal person.
Yeah.
You know, each individual person. So I'm very good at observing and reading it, and I don't, you know, bring attention to when I come. I'm
yeah.
here for one reason. I'm like a Kawhi Leonard.
Yeah.
To be on
you
the topic.
You are like a Kawhi Leonard.
I'm happily will say I'm like a
you
Kawhi
are,
Leonard.
You are like a, speaking of Kawhi Leonard, who do you got?
I'm going Kawhi Leonard all day.
And how many games?
Just because Toronto with the six and all that,
yeah,
we'll
yeah.
go six.
All right, Mark, you hear that.
We'll go six. Will Golden State win? Probably, but I'm going for Kawhi, because you know what? There was an interview last night that he did.
Yeah.
And it was perfect. It was a perfect example. And he was talking, some guy asked him about LeBron, you know, how LeBron and Steph Curry get all the hype in the NBA, blah, blah, blah. And do you feel like that bothers you? Or whatever his question
right, right,
was.
Right, right,
and
right.
he was just like, I'm not playing this game for the hype and the fame and all of that and the attention. I just like it for the sport, and I love the sport, and I'm here to win and play back. Like,
right.
it's literally that simple in a sense.
Yeah.
And I feel like I've taken many opportunities and jobs off of a feeling rather than money.
Right.
And I am currently doing jobs for
yeah.
a feeling, not the money, because
right.
I know there's people that I could most likely get more out of, but it's just inside
yeah.
here. So.
And the money will come.
So it was applying that with...
What is it about basketball and the hip hop culture? I would love to know who you're
yeah.
listening to right now. But what's it about basketball, the hip hop culture, and that grooming scene?
That all
goes together.
I look at it as basketball is a sport where being game day fresh is the thing.
Mm-hmm.
There's no helmets. There's lots of camera time.
Yeah.
You can almost not have to be a star to get camera time. They
right.
go to the bench. They go to the players.
Right.
You make one wrong move.
You
it's
get,
a zoom in.
And you get got.
Exactly.
I mean, they hit that LeBron.
Oh, yeah.
He came back. What's the season, Mark? What was that? He came back looking fresh.
Exactly.
What year was that?
I think it was 2011. It's just with basketball, it's more noticeable.
Yeah, man.
It's just like these guys are, you know, 82 games out of the season, that's a lot of TV. That's a lot of time to notice, hey, he didn't look like that last game.
A lot of Twitter.
Exactly, and a lot of Twitter. You know,
yeah.
a lot of the guys are younger too, but they're into, it just comes with it all. They're into the fresh cuts. They're into the look. Nowadays, the NBA is inspiring the younger crowd with the cool hair, you know,
yeah.
James Harden and all
right.
of that. So,
right.
like, being game day fresh became a thing.
Right.
With basketball, you know, football is a thing, even though they wear helmets.
Right.
Baseball and hockey were like the only two that weren't so much, but
yeah.
you know, soccer, like athletes kind of put it out there, like getting that fresh look was a thing
yeah.
for game day. So
absolutely.
To the younger crowd that inspires them, and it's, you know.
It's interesting
so
to see
that. That's what drew my attention growing up, being a big sports fan, mainly basketball. It was like, for me, my goal, and I will get there for sure,
yeah.
is to, you know, gain an NBA player
yeah.
and or an athlete
right.
and just watch my work on TV. And enjoy the game, but, you know.
What do you feel for you, like, you know, when I see some of our work, when we put it out there,
mm-hmm.
we're behind the scenes, you're a behind the scenes guy
mm-hmm.
too. There's something like, when I see our work out there, you feel like that's, it's the reverse, because we're not standing on the stage. But
yeah.
when you see your guy dropping at the Grammys,
right.
you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's,
do
that,
you,
I mean,
how does that feel like?
It's like a... it's hard to explain. It's definitely a big, big feeling, you know, even though it's something so simple, but this is all, like, I know this is my,
right.
this is my everything. Like
right.
doing hair is me. So like for me to know that my work over the years, and when you look back where I started, you know, everyone in the garage
absolutely.
And just the journey, the different places to like knowing that it made its way on a red carpet is kind of
yeah.
like, it's big to me. It doesn't even matter the person. It could have been an assistant. But,
yeah.
you know, just knowing that It says a lot.
And too, for me, like when I leave your chair, like I feel better about me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's crazy. Not a lot of things that make you feel that way.
Yeah, I think I wanted to put that out there. Not like say, all right, next person comes in, I'm going to make them feel good. Right. I just feel like I naturally set up this life and this style of work specifically for a reason. And this wasn't one of them, but it came with it.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted to be private. I wanted to have my own room and just kind of like work. When I'm so busy, I come to the salon and I just work.
Right.
But what it turned into is like this therapist office haircut session. Right. That's why I don't like to say, call me your barber, but call me your hair guy. Like, this is my guy.
Yeah.
It's like more of, we've talked about so much in here, and then you close the door and you're on with your day. But I feel like I have files of clients and their stories and everything. So it's like my goal then, when I have no one around, no boss to look over my shoulder, no one put a timer on me, no walking coming in, disrupting my train of focus here, I naturally give more. And I think I give more to this specific person than to the cut. Like I make it the cut, but it adapts to your lifestyle, to your feeling, current situation. That's the spring or summer, whatever it is. Just like I try to cater it as much to you and know that it's just me and you in here. And this is a one-on-one thing. So overall, that feeling that I get out of that is like you couldn't put a price on it.
What do you feel like has been your biggest struggle? Like if you look at like where you come from,
balancing
where you are.
The demand now, that everything I've asked for is starting to come and realizing it's still just me, you know, and I like it and this is what I want, but just kind of like my biggest struggle has been balancing, you know, this work life and my personal life.
Yeah,
I've kind of stepped away from it a lot.
And it hurts, right?
It does. It hurts bad because you don't realize you I'm in such a giving industry and I give so much, you know, all day long for almost a decade now.
Yeah.
Sometimes like giving to all I know is how to give to others in a sense.
Right.
When I give to me, it's so small
so
and
small,
it's like this
isolated.
Much time because like most of the day is gone. So it's like I get used to that and it's harder to give me more time because.
Right. And then when you're working with celebs and artists, you get that call, I need you right now.
Yeah,
I need you
and
in
it's
an
just
hour.
Like, I might as well not take off, or I might as well not take this vacation. I don't even know how I can leave, you know?
And
like, for example, with today, it's just one of those days
of those days.
It was like,
yo,
man, text.
Yo.
So, but it's showing me progress and growth. I would like to say it's growing pains in a good way, you know?
Man. All right, we're going to do something I like to call rapid fire.
Rapid fire.
So rapid fire is I'm just going to ask you a few questions. You got like 5 seconds to answer these questions as best as you possibly can. I need to find these questions.
5 seconds.
So here we go.
Seconds.
Just real easy ones, real easy ones. I'm going to start you off. Okay, here we go. LA or New York?
LA.
City or beach?
Beach.
Instagram, Facebook?
Ooh. Instagram got me farther.
Okay. Oh, that's interesting to know. Okay. Let's see. If you could be one person right now, who would you be? R. Kelly or Michael Jackson?
Oh, man. Wow. That's real.
It's rough.
I think, I don't think there's a right answer, but.
I think so either.
After just seeing Michael Jackson.
Yeah. Hey, he's gone. I don't know. Hey, I don't know what you're going to say.
More of a legend, I guess.
Alcohol of choice. When you're out, what are you drinking? What's your drink?
Whiskey tequila.
Whiskey tequila.
Getting
it done.
Yeah, just those two.
Man. Well, thanks for coming and hanging out with
me.
I really appreciate
man.
It. Tell everybody on Instagram where they can follow you.
You
see
guys
your stuff.
Can find me at Dan Perri Hair. That's DanPerri, not Y.
Absolutely.
Keeps it different. Dan Perri Hair. That's also the website, danperrihair.com and danperri.hair@gmail.com. So
hit him up.
Stay connected,
hit
guys.
Hit him up. Follow him. Anybody that's aspiring as a business owner, seeing how you took a risk and made it work out, this is the man to kind of check out. Dude, thanks for coming to hang out
with
me.
My pleasure, man. It's been great.
All
glad to share the story.
Talk to you soon.
All righty.